Hello. Are you able to see properly now? Please let me know if you are able to see the screen. Is it semi-live or not yet? Okay, so we have a confirmation that both YouTube and Twitch are working. So again, welcome, and I hope that everybody is still healthy and able to properly attend all the classes. So today we will focus mainly on the UI component part. As we discussed with some of you at laboratories, we At the first part of the laboratories, we will focus on the UI side of the applications. And we will discuss, if we will have time, about how to retrieve resources. But first, let's for everybody establish some deadlines. So we will have five projects, big projects. The first, or six, if we are counting also the project description, which is something that everybody can easily do. So, as due dates, for some of you, the project details will be for next week, and for the rest, the week after. And in the project details, we will establish, from the point of view of a potential client, let's say, what are the requirements for the other four projects? And here we have split them by laboratories. So in the third and fourth laboratory, we will focus only on the UI side. And the third one will be dedicated for the native part. So there we need to build the UI part only with mock in-memory data to be able to demo the CRUD operations, so create, read, update, and delete operations. The read operation will be demoed as a list, and today we will discuss on how we can build a list of elements. And the same thing should be done in a non-native framework, a framework that will allow us to build our app for both of the major platforms, so Android and iOS as well. And that will be due to the fourth laboratory. After that, you will have the choice to be able to implement both of the instead of implementing in both of the platforms, native and non-native, you will have the choice to implement only one of them, so at your choosing, either native or non-native, to add DB support. That will mean that all the CRUD operations should be available without an internet connection, and everything should be persisted on the device. So all those operations should work without an internet connection and survive restarts. And for the last laboratory, the one that will be in the next year, we will focus on adding support for a server-side operations. And so everything should still work with a local DB, but we will persist also everything on a server too, and we will retrieve information from the server as well. This will allow us to synchronize data between multiple devices. I'm seeing that someone is saying that the camera has a lag. So from my side, from what I'm seeing here, we don't have any dropped frames, so maybe something in between. Please check your stream side. So from what I'm seeing, I'm able to push at the proper bandwidth, and we are not losing anything. So for more details, please check the lecture page, the lab plan. There we have specified at the high level everything that's required and with specific dates. Like I said, the CRUD application should be implemented on the UI side for native, and here we have choices as Kotlin, Java, Objective-C, or Swift. And for non-native, we are recommending Flutter, but you can use any, so React Native, Native Scripts, Ionic, or any other framework that supports multi-platform. And here, if you are selecting something else, please discuss with your lab coordinator to establish if that framework is available for building applications on both of the platforms. And the UI side, we need both, so it's not a choice. So you should build your UI side for native and non-native. But after that, so that's only the UI side. After that, we will focus on only one. So you will choose either native or non-native to implement the DB and the network variations of the app. Today, like I said, we will focus on the UI side, and to be able to discuss about how we should organize our applications and to understand what's happening in let's say activity. So all the screens in Android and if you like also on the iOS side, they are represented by unit of work. In activity, in Android, that's named an activity. And when we are starting an activity, we have some callbacks that will allow us as a developer to react based on the internal states of that activity. So right at the beginning, we will have the onCreate state. That's representing the callback where we will construct the internal parts of the activity, our UI side, if you like. OnStart is the callback that will allow us to properly initialize the UI context. OnResume is something that will be used to re-establish the content of our UI screens. And once all of those callbacks are finished, our application is in the running state. That means that the activity is present on the screen. The user is able to see our screen. And also in technical terms, that means that our application is in a foreground state. Okay? If the application is leaving the foreground, so it's either covered by another activity or by another application, then the internal state moves on another state named pause. And here we will receive the on pause callback. And this one is established for giving us the choice on releasing resources or catching the user's input, let's say, to be able to restore it on resume, let's say, if the activity will return in the running status. If the user is no longer, let's say, using the activity after a while, sometimes we will receive the on stop callback. And if the activity is destroyed, so the user is dismissing the activity or the operating system is dismissing the activity, we can receive the onDestroy callback. You'll see in the reference that both onStop and onDestroy may be skipped. So if you would like to ensure that the user's input is captured, we should deal with it on the onPause callback. If the user returns to our activity either from onPause or onStop, we have dedicated callbacks. For onPause, we have the onResume. Like I said, we will be able to restore the user context from that state, or from pause if the user is getting back to our activity, let's say after a phone call or after switching from another application, we will get another intermediate callback named on restart that will allow us to restore the UI components or to recreate them if they were destroyed. And after that, we are following the same on start and on resume callbacks. From on stop, if the application was killed, or from pause, if the applications were killed by the operating system, we will get the on create callback as recreating everything from scratch as the application was started, let's say. So those are all the callbacks that we as developers are having access to in order to react and to prepare our screens for the user. So let's see what we have on the chat. So someone is saying that we should switch the stream output. We will try this after the break probably. So I will lower the stream frame rate. And someone is saying that we have some dropped frames because the stream is stopping like 3 seconds apart. Maybe it's happening. I'm not seeing it from my side. So maybe it's an encoding issue. We are anyway recording everything. So if you have issues right now, you can still watch the recorded version. I'm seeing also messages that are saying that for them it's working. We will try to adjust on the break the stream. Okay, so right now we will switch to a demo here where we will try to replicate some of the callbacks to understand how we can react from our application. And for this we prepared some applications on the GitHub repository. So on lecture 2 you'll see all the applications that are presented here. And right now we will open, so from the GitHub repository in lectures, lecture 2, we have an app named Lifecycle app, which is an empty activity application. So we created here what we had last time, the onCreate method, and we will demo the lifecycle using some logs. And in order to do that, we will define an utility. So let's switch here to Android view to filter out some of the information. And we will create a new Kotlin file named utils. You'll see that we will have in most of our demo projects, we will already have this utils file. And here we are defining an extension function. An extension function is a way for us to add capabilities to existing classes. Okay, so here we will add an extension to the any class, Any in Kotlin is something similar to the object class in Java. So it's a class, a parent base class, if you like, for all the available types. And we will add a method named logd from logdebug. And for this method, we will have a message field of type string, and then we will have a cause of type throwable here, and that can be null. So here we can see how we are declaring a function. So the keyword fun is specifying that we are declaring a function. Then, because we would like to add an extension to the any existing class, we are using the any dot notation and then the name of the extension. And as arguments, we have those two. And the last one is an optional one because it has a default value. And because we would like to support null values, we are using the question mark notation. And we are specifying here